Okay, thank you. Thank you for this opportunity to share my views on this very important subject of evaluation in developing countries. In many ways, I find and I think that evaluation holds to the key, holds the key to the future of our countries in terms of its importance for ensuring equity, importance for ensuring efficient use of resources, in terms of delivering on commitments made to people, and in terms of strengthening accountability. I've often wondered, when we started on the subject, why focus on developing countries, and in what ways is evaluation different and more challenging in developing countries than in developed countries? I think this is an important question to address because I've met a number of policymakers and public administrators who remark that they do not find evaluations particularly useful. And as I've spoken to them, they identified three main reasons for this. First, they feel that evaluations as conducted today in developing countries do not really throw light on why change has occurred or why it hasn't, whether the change that is observed is going to be long-lasting or it's going to be temporary and disappear. And finally, they're not very clear on what are the lessons that one can draw from these evaluations for scaling up of the interventions. How important are these? How replicable are these? Now, before I elaborate on some of these points, I want to take a few minutes to set the stage for policy formulation in developing countries in a sense that sets the stage for evaluation as well. The fundamental question that we have to ask ourselves is evaluation of what? And there is a growing consensus among development practitioners that development is not about producing more and more goods and services or about expanding GDP alone. Growth is important, but it has increasingly come to be accepted that development has to focus on people and people's lives, how they are affected by policy and programs that governments put in place. And in doing this, the yardsticks for judging progress have to be different from traditional conventional ones that economists would tend to use. So the focus now is on asking whether interventions have led to an enhancement of people's capabilities. This could be in terms of improvements in life expectancy or in child survival. It could be in terms of employability. It could be the capability to acquire skills and so on. Whether there has been a widening of opportunities. In fact, development has much to do with an expansion of opportunities. And here we are not just looking at economic opportunities, but also social opportunities, political opportunities, and cultural opportunities. And as Professor Amartya Sen most recently said, argues, development is about enlarging freedoms and the freedoms of people to do what they want to do and be what they want to be. Now, when you adopt this kind of a perspective of development, then I just want to point too quickly that the notion of poverty also undergoes a change. Therefore, when we're looking at people's lives, and particularly concentrating on the poor, we are not really looking at income deprivation alone, but we are looking more broadly at the poverty of opportunities. In fact, recognizing that life is multidimensional, this perspective also argues that poverty has many deprivations embedded in it. So illiteracy, malnutrition, lack of empowerment are all dimensions of poverty that one must take into account. In this perspective, for example, income deprivation is only one type of deprivation, and income poverty is an outcome. It is an outcome of the denial of opportunities. So any framework that we use for an evaluative framework must look at what has been the impact on the opportunities that are available to people. And lastly, in the same spirit, when we talk about equality in the human development framework, we are not talking necessarily about the redistribution of income and wealth, but more fundamentally about equality of opportunities between women and men across regions, across communities, and so on. Therefore, What is the implication of this when we are talking about policy in developing countries? One of the first things is that the focus shifts from looking at projects and looking more specifically at people. And this means that we are looking at whether interventions and policies are helping to end deprivations, whether they are ending inequalities, whether there is an element of social justice, and what happens when you look at power relations in society, and look at vulnerabilities, and so on and so forth. Very often, this bigger overarching picture is forgotten, and evaluations adopt a very narrow focus, and this limits the usefulness of evaluations. Therefore, when you're looking at the context of when you're talking about evaluation from a developing country lens, the fundamental shifts that arise, therefore, are to ask whether the intervention has contributed to greater empowerment, whether it has enhanced the security of people, whether it has promoted equity, whether it has contributed to ending discrimination. Just on the point of discrimination, we always talk about access being equitable, and there's a major push by many governments to ensure universal access. But universal access does not necessarily mean non-discrimination, because there are several instances where both boys and girls may be going to school, but still the kinds of discrimination that girls face in schools is very different from that faced by boys. Similarly, if you're belonging to an ethnic minority, you may all be receiving the same kind of health care access, but the kind of treatment you get may be very different. So essentially, therefore, we are saying that the evaluative questions become quite complicated, and when you're talking about the practice of evaluation, we must begin by recognizing that there are no easy answers, and it's not such a simple exercise. And I want to take the next few minutes to answer the question, what makes the challenge of evaluation in developing countries quite formidable and calls for very new ways of looking at evaluation. The first point that I want to make is that when you're looking at development challenges in these countries, they are far more profound than what you would get anywhere else. You're talking about transformative change. We don't know the processes that underlie these changes. Sometimes the results that you observe may be very transient. They are unpredictable. This has to do with a lot of vested interests and power relations that prevail in society. So you suddenly find that there is a whole complicated politics of development that comes into play. There's a preference for status quo, and many of the interventions end up being just tinkering with existing systems, but are not really getting down to addressing the fundamental causes of deprivation and poverty that we are talking about. Understanding change, again, which is, when I started the presentation, I said one of the challenges that policymakers pose to evaluators is that the evaluation does not contribute to an understanding of change. Now, understanding change in developing countries is a complicated exercise. I just want to draw your attention to an excellent article by Roman Krisnarik, who raises four types of questions when you're trying to understand the logic of change. The first question, he says, is who or what was involved in this change? This itself is a very fundamental question, because the stakeholders, it's easy to say we're talking about stakeholders, but there are a large number of them. There are a large number of groups, beneficiary groups, people's groups, civil society groups, government institutions, plus other institutions. So, and all of them have their own agendas, their own set of mandates. Some of them will overlap, others may not. And so understanding who and what their motivation is and their role is itself is a major step. Here we are, like they say, we are not looking for attribution, but even to understand the contribution of these actors is fundamental to understanding a good evaluation. The second question, what are the strategies that are being used to bring about the change? And here also, it is sometimes I find that the paper, the document has a particular strategy, but the way it plays out on the field is very different, because when real people get involved in the implementation of strategies, there is a certain amount of unpredictability that comes about, which is important to recognize. The third question he talks about is the context. You know, what were the contexts that affected how the change happened? Here again, this is again a very critical question, and I'll come back to it in terms of the lessons learned, that the significance of the contextual factors that influence outcomes is fundamental. And it's very difficult often to explain why something's happened. It could be because of the nature of the power relationships, it could be a function of leadership, it could be a function of excellent bureaucracy, but to get a handle on this is quite complicated. And lastly, is what is the process or pathways of change? This is very, again, critical for evaluation, for good evaluation. In fact, when people say that many of these processes are not replicable or are not clearly understood, it has to do with not having a clear idea of what these pathways are. The third challenge when you're talking about evaluation in developing countries has to do with defining outcomes itself. Like I started in the beginning, we have ideas of empowerment, which are central to understanding what is happening to people's lives. But what exactly is empowerment? Defining it is difficult. We may think we have an idea of what is economic empowerment, but what about political empowerment? We talk about participation in electoral processes, we talk about participation in meetings and so on, but does that really, really translate into political empowerment, into fair representation of disadvantaged groups in influencing public decisions and so on, are difficult questions to explain. So when we're talking about outcomes of programs or policies, even to define the contours of outcomes is quite a challenge. Moving on, even after defining the outcomes, measuring the outcome and performance is even more complicated. For example, we talk about improvements in self-esteem. I mentioned about the issue of non-discrimination among boys and girls in the classroom. How do you measure this? Clearly, it cannot be done through quantitative indicators alone. You need very sophisticated ways of figuring out aspects of non-discrimination or inequitable treatment. So you need innovation, you need creativity, you need very different kinds of measures and milestones and indicators that can track performance. And I find that in many of our situations, while the documents pledge to achieve major outcomes, the measures and the indicators are seriously lacking in terms of the ability to capture and track performance and progress. Let me move on to the fifth one, and this again I mentioned in the beginning, and I want to re-emphasize the importance of contexts in developing countries. Even in a country like India, where I work, we often say that no two states are similar. You have the southern state of Kerala, which has done exceptionally well in social sector development. But when we say what are the lessons from Kerala that can be applied to the rest of India, the constant answer you will get is that, oh, well, Kerala is very different. The other states don't enjoy the same socio-cultural or development characteristics. So the heterogeneity of populations itself is a problem. So when you're evaluating a national program and seeing whether it's working in one region and not in another, it is so important to understand what are the socio-cultural beliefs and practices. Again, coming from my own country of India, the discrimination against women and the anti-female biases are quite pervasive across the country, but they manifest themselves very starkly in some regions and not so starkly in others. So when you're talking about gender empowerment and gender equality and how women have benefited or not, the factoring in the role of socio-cultural beliefs becomes central to evaluation. So in a sense, what happens then is that it is not whether the one intervention is right and the other intervention is wrong, but the same intervention in two contexts can produce very different outcomes. That is fundamentally what evaluation has to recognize, and the richness of evaluations lies in understanding the context and seeing how interventions play out in terms of the privilege, power and confidence differentials, in terms of the practice of democracy. Well, we have various forms of democracy, some representational, some very pro-poor, but not necessarily delivering what we expect them to deliver. And lastly, in these contexts, there is the politics of evaluation. And there is a great reluctance, there is a very great reluctance to for evaluation in these countries. This has to do with entrenched political interests. It has to do with entrenched bureaucratic interests. There is a resistance to public evaluations. There is a resistance to making good evaluations public. And so understanding why something is working or not working is also points to the fact or the importance of making evaluation public, getting more people involved in the evaluation and trying to get the messages out to the public. The sixth point, I'm coming close to the end of my presentation, is that the evaluation function itself in developing countries is constrained by a number of factors. The first has to do with limited information itself. I refer to a number of indicators and potential indicators, but collecting information on them is difficult. In fact, even on conventional indicators, many of the disaggregated data that may point to differentials in access or differentials in quality, etc., are not readily available. Second, we all know about the constraints of financial resources. And this itself is quite paradoxical, that while governments devote large sums of money, they invest large sums of money in health and education and nutrition programs, for instance, a very, very small fraction, a negligible fraction, is kept for evaluation. In fact, it's such a small, minuscule amount compared to the overall budget that it absolutely signals the lack of interest or the lack of recognition of the importance of evaluation, especially when such large amounts of resources are being spent. Third, you have the limited human resource capacity. This again is an old problem. We don't really have adequate capacities for both governance, administering programs, and conducting evaluations at the local levels, at the district levels, at the subnational levels, and so on. We have limited civil society engagement. In fact, increasingly it is found that where civil society organizations and community-based organizations are active in local governance, outcomes tend to be better. But the capacity of civil society groups varies. The evaluations that I have seen rarely look into the ways of strengthening civil society organizations. What are their constraints? How do you enhance their capacities and make a more holistic assessment of the capacities of different stakeholders, and particularly civil society organizations? And lastly, I talked about limited evaluation capacity. In fact, this also raises the question of what kinds of evaluations. There are some conventional evaluations and conventional methods where you can do evaluation using checklists. But these really get reduced to symbolisms. And in developing countries, it is not just the complexity of the context and the development challenge, but the kinds of evaluation we are talking about require very extraordinary capacities to do these evaluations. For instance, if you're doing a training program to enhance the capacity of politicians, what would be the outcomes? How would you measure the benefits of this training program, and so on? They're very complicated exercises. We're talking about capacity building, we're talking about institutional building, and these require capacities to look at very complex systems. Lastly, this is my last slide, and I say all this to highlight that when you're talking about evaluation in developing countries, and we are making a plea for a very different kind of an approach that is innovative, what are we really calling for? First, we say that the evaluator needs to have an excellent understanding of the local context, because these evaluations are extremely complicated, and that understanding is fundamental to policymakers recognizing the usefulness of evaluations, to the people, the communities recognizing that what is being found out and reported is indeed useful to them. This raises the question of involvement of local evaluators. I find that this is again a very complicated question. I'm sure Zenda in her presentation that follows will talk about it, but how do you really combine, get a good mix of local people who have an understanding of the context but may not have the evaluation skills, combine them with professional evaluators from outside, and how do you really manage this dynamics for better outcomes? I've talked about mixed methods. The only point I would like to make here is in the key for getting more innovative measures, we have to use very creative ways of both developing objective and subjective indicators. We need to find new ways of collecting this information and converting that information into knowledge and making it available. I have talked briefly about performance measures, which is linked to what we are trying to measure and how, linked again to the kinds of knowledge systems that we need to generate. In fact, how do you make the evaluation results more accessible, more understandable, more available to people? And this brings me to the last point, which actually ties up with what I'm saying in terms of putting evaluation in the hands of people, which I've used the word democratization of evaluation. In fact, it should be evaluation for the people, evaluation of the people, and evaluation by the people, in that sense, that we really have to make evaluation a kind of very powerful tool in the hands of people who can then use it to demand better services, to demand an enforcement of their rights, to make demands on the state for better use of resources, and so on and so forth. And actually, that becomes the basis for better accountability and better development results. So I'm going to stop there and say that there's a lot of exciting things to do in the field of evaluation in developing countries. The challenges are many. There are several experiments going on in the developing world which are trying to grapple with these questions, and the time is right to bring these experiences together and make a significant contribution to the field of evaluation. Thank you.
Okay, Zenda, thank you, Shiv, for that great opening address. Now, Zenda Ofir is going to give us a talk on her perspectives on a developing country lens on evaluation. Zenda?
Zenda, please use your mic. Click on your mic, please.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. I really appreciate the fact that Rockefeller Foundation and partners are interested in how evaluation methodologies would look like if they were developing countries. Of course, we do some of that. But they're really interested in knowing whether there are certain characteristics in methodologies or approaches to evaluation that we in developing countries would actually really love to see and actually demand. And so I'm very pleased about the opportunity to try to stimulate our thinking. What Shiv and I are presenting are not supposed to be comprehensive, but it's supposed to make us think about what we want in developing countries, what we want to see done when evaluations take place and when methodologies are developed. So the first, let me just get my slides here. So the first question we have to ask is whether there is in fact a set of generic, let's say, principles that can actually constitute a developing country lens on evaluation. And of course we believe that there is. But if you agree, then should we be more assertive about these aspects when we do evaluations or when we commission evaluations? And those who shape evaluation practice, the people who fund or commission evaluations especially, what will inspire them to look at these aspects more seriously than perhaps has been done to date? And if you don't agree, how do we ensure that evaluation does less harm in developing countries? Because we know that it's not as empowering and as useful as it should be. Some of what we are going to say is not new, but we really believe that it's important not to lose a focus on these issues. And therefore we combined the 10 that jumped out at us for this presentation today, the 10 principles that we believe we should kind of insist on when we work with evaluation in developing countries. But there are more, and you may disagree, and that's part of our discussion today. So what is the first principle? As you can see, we really need to understand better how change happens, and Shiv referred to Krishnarik's, it's just one of many good articles about the flaws in current development models, because how change is actually happening is not well understood. So we believe that in order to have sustained, effective, enduring development, we need to understand far better how change actually happens. And that is why we are very pleased that at the moment there is really a very great focus on the frameworks on developing theories of change that's far more sophisticated and less rigid than the old log frames that we have so much in development that has done so much harm because they're applied in such superficial and rigid ways. So we believe that we have to develop far more detailed theories of change, backed up perhaps by more frameworks from the literature, because we tend not to look at literature very often and the frameworks that can guide us about how change happens. We also need to ensure that the change logic, the theory of change, is documented, is monitored, it's tested and revised as part of project management or policy management. So the causal pathways, the feedback loops, and far deeper interrogation of the underlying assumptions that's developed in far more detailed ways is what we need. We really need to get away from rigid, undetailed, superficial thinking about change. We need to really engage with the assumptions that we make when we develop interventions. And we really need to engage with context that change and the implications of that. And we really need to engage with complexity. And as you know, there is now much work being done on simple interventions compared to complicated interventions compared to complex interventions. And what I often see is that giant leaps are taken when people think they have a log frame without dissecting what's actually going on underneath. And I believe a lot of damage is done because we do not engage properly with how complex change actually is. Our second principle then is that we need to evaluate for transformative positive change. So clearly we need to understand what transformative change means. It's not, we should not just focus on what some people call episodic or developmental change. When you look at the definitions of this, I trust that it is clear what transformation or transformative change actually means. And our thesis is that you get really sustained positive change only when it's transformative, really. And yet you'll see that much of the efforts in evaluation go into episodic and developmental change. Look at what is transformative change. It's fundamental shifts in individuals or groups or organizations or institutions or countries, values and perspectives. Shifts in paradigms, in worldviews, in vision, in careers, in organizational direction, in social political reforms. These are normally regenerative moments or radical redirections. It's when people's mindsets and understanding change and they actually come to believe something different to what was before. So one should look in evaluations for those moments and those opportunities and those types of change. Our first principle is that we need to be far more serious about evaluating for unintended negative consequences. There's normally a little question at the end of a survey or an interview about did you pick up anything that's negative, or maybe something that's not the set of outcomes that we pre-designed 5 years ago. This is really not good enough. And there are so many examples of this, and I just want to mention a few. I mean, we know that, for example, in gender programs, there's often an unintended consequences of a backlash from men that make life much more difficult for women. Or in child labor, some of the work that I was involved in, where commercial activities move from factories into homes, which is much difficult then to trace and to regulate. Or a very prominent one, the Green Revolution in India, which made people dependent on large companies, seeds, provision and pricing, vulnerable to their commercial interests, for example, and also the serious health and environmental concerns in the long run, just because people did not focus enough on unintended negative consequences. And as I move around the developing world in Africa and Asia especially, I see a tremendous amount of unintended consequences that will have far-reaching effects and certainly stop any notion of development that can be sustained. So we as evaluators should search far more actively in our methods for this kind of consequence. Number four, principle four, to focus on privilege, power, and empowerment is absolutely crucial. And this is at different levels. It's to do with the power relationships and power asymmetries within an intervention, say between the funder, the project managers, or the policy implementers, and the participants. It is also very much to do with, at a different level, with whether interventions and the way they're done, both the process and the way in which we envisage the change to happen, or the reasons for the change, whether these empower people, whether it gives them confidence to continue, and all this, also the skills. So I'm also very concerned about the fact that we often evaluate without recognizing the importance of true empowerment, and we don't use literature or past lessons about what empowerment actually means. And so it's really very important. By the way, this is also very important even in analyzing why developing countries are sometimes not assertive when dealing, let's say, with groups of donors or international organizations on an international stage. That is improving now. It's a matter perhaps of countries also gaining confidence as we move forward. But evaluators should be very aware of this. And just one framework that's already been in use for quite a while is an analysis of the power and whether people or groups or institutions are empowered by looking at these four elements. We can't go through this in any detail, but this exists. Power within, you look at whether power within people has changed. The power to, in other words, choices have increased. Power over, which is sometimes very negative in terms of the underlying resource and power constraints, and power worth, which is increasing solidarity and joint action with others. So when a program has a focus on empowerment, it is very important to try to analyze these different dimensions. And there are also many other models and frameworks that have been developed that we need to use, and I just list a few. The power cube is a useful instrument, force field analysis, and very interesting relational approach. which really says that our own notion of power is very different in some cultural contexts where it's relationships and building and developing relationships that create positive change, not the money that you provide. The money is just a tool to reinforce, establish relationships. So there are many different views to and models to view empowerment. We need to use them far more frequently. Principle 5, attending to multicultural validity. You know, we focus on internal, on external, and so on validity. Karen Kirkhardt developed the notion of multicultural validity, and some of us may have issues with that, but the point is, because we work in different cultures, we really need to be far more aware of, let's say, these five different ways in which cultural differences play out that we as evaluators should be aware of. We should not just think about that culture is about shaking the chief's hands when you go to a village. It's far beyond that. It's far deeper than that. It really touches on how we devise methodologies. So, multicultural validity looks at the cultural appropriateness of the measurements, the tools we measure in the designs, the social consequences of understandings and judgments and the actions that are being taken, the quality of interactions between and the non-participants in the evaluation and also in the intervention, the lived experience and whether what we find is congruent with the lived experience of people, and also in theoretical congruence. In other words, is what we do and what we implement congruent with the theoretical foundations around change in that particular society? Again, far too little attention is paid to this. And just to reinforce this, if you look at the values underlying cultural differences in different societies, we can't go through this, but an intervention and an evaluation may look quite different when we look at, for example, the difference between traditional societies, say in the East, to some extent also in Africa, and Western industrialized systems, where in one case the status and relationships determined by age and role in the family or in the group, while we are very individual in the West. We are in traditional societies, it's much more about cooperation. In Western societies, it's much more about competition. Spiritualism, materialism. These are very fundamental impacts on how we do interventions and how we evaluate. Number 6, and the last one that I'm going to discuss, which is one the closest to my heart, because I see so often that developments just fail because you get maybe good impacts or good results for a year, and then when everybody leaves, a year later, it's all gone. And we have in the DAC evaluation criteria and in CIE's impact evaluations, we have a focus on sustainability, but it's either poorly implemented or narrowly defined. So I just want to bring Patricia Rogers and Bob Williams' definition. It's concerned with the likelihood of achieving benefits from a time-limited intervention that are sustained after the intervention has ended. It's about the sustainment of the benefits as well. So some of the questions one may want to ask, what is the level of sustainability of intervention of this time? Is it likely that it will be sustained? How good is the potential? Are things in place that make the chance that it will be sustained higher? Should the intervention in fact be sustained? Or are we happy if it dies and the benefits hopefully sustain? How can the sustainability of the intervention and its benefits be maximized? We really need to dig far deeper into this. And Patricia Rogers and Bob Williams have just identified certain pathways, for example, you increase the chance that benefits will be sustained by sustaining, by ensuring capacity of intervention target groups are properly built, that activities by organizations are continued in some other form, that organizational capacities are sustained, that the idea is sustained. So this is much wider than either just the focus on the environment, which is very often what sustainability means, or just a focus on whether the intervention itself sustained. Far beyond that, we need to see whether things are done in a manner that will help enable sustainability. And there are now quite a number of models, like Struven and Schroeder has developed a sustainability checklist, and there are others who have done quite a significant amount of work on this. Also, I see in Israel and so on, there are certainly a whole lot of work coming out, but it's not being applied and demanded by the commissioners. And then, finally, just because we don't have time, I just want to mention these very briefly. Impact evaluations should refer to the fact that we need to look at the heterogeneity of outcomes and make sure that we evaluate for that. We need to interrogate the role of context. As we mentioned, we must make sure that the evaluation process itself empowers people rather than disempower them. And finally, perhaps one of the most important, we must ensure that evaluations are of high quality, using evaluation standards, making them rigorous, where rigor is broadly defined beyond the technical and also applied throughout the evaluation process, and not the spin that is currently there, that rigorous evaluations refer only to a particular type of evaluation or hierarchy of evaluations. This is going to skew development and really bring us into dire straits if this notion of quality and rigor persists. But at the same time, we have to be far more careful that we will indeed have high-quality evaluations throughout the evaluation process. And with that, my time is certainly gone. Thank you very much for listening.